Yeah, I'm Stephen Hummel. I'm dark sky specialist for McDonald Observatory. My job is to keep the skies dark for the area surrounding the observatory for the research we do, as well as for public enjoyment. But yeah, we have some of the darkest skies in the United States. I'm not sure if I should be looking at the camera or looking at you. I guess I'm talking to you. I should be looking at you. We have some of the darkest skies in the United States in this region, and we're trying to maintain that status here.
All right. Well, I'm the public that is enjoying the dark skies in this. So thank you. And so we're here trying to raise some money for the getting the International Dark Skies Association designation for Dark Sky Reserve.
That's exactly right. Yeah, okay. You sound so hesitant, but you're exactly right. So, we are pursuing status with the IDA, the International Dark Sky Association, for a Dark Sky Reserve in the greater Big Bend region, most of the area, and will be the largest reserve of its kind in the world at almost 10 million acres.
So wait, how many counties is that?
It'll be the three tri-county areas, we call it. It's Presidio, Brewster, and Jeff Davis counties. Plus a little sliver of Reeves County near Balmoray, as well as three protected lands across the border in Mexico.
In Mexico. And so how far down into Mexico are...
It would be Ocampo, Sierra del Carmen, and Madero Canyon, all those three protected lands. You couldn't see across it from anywhere. If you stood in the middle of the reserve, you would not be able to see across the reserve from even on the clearest days.
All right.
So like how does the night sky influence your paintings? Like how do you incorporate it into your work?
Well, so I love detail. So part of the reason, I mean, there's always, when I'm painting, there's always nine reasons for everything, right? It's never one thing leads to another. It's like there's this whole soup that I've had on the back of the burner for 20, 30, 40 years that I keep throwing things that I'm interested in into the soup, and then stuff bubbles to the top. And so with the dark skies, you know, I live here, so every night I go out before bed and I look at the stars and I think about the stars. And then I started painting the stars. I was painting like that one. So I was painting water, and then so learning how to do water, and then I started getting interested in the pattern of the stars, and so I started painting. But what any excuse, in older paintings, I painted blades of grass. It's pretty much any excuse to have little tiny patterns, and I love details. And it's also comforting to me to paint details. Like if I'm in a place where I don't want to be and I'm afraid, and yeah, I'll close my eyes and I paint grass, or I paint stars, or, you know, and so that's part of it. And then
why do you think it's comforting to you? Why these patterns? Do you know, or is this just something more base than more instinctual?
Yeah, I have no, I need to shrink, but instead I can just pick up a paintbrush and do it, and I can just do, I can just do that. So it's that, but then, so dark skies, so it started with that one piece, the piece that we've got, that we're doing the t-shirt and the print for the fundraiser. It was like, so I started painting a sky, and then I found this collage piece, and I put them together, and then, oh, that made me think of everything about how I felt, the feeling that I feel when I look up at the Milky Way and ponder my littleness, and so that's part of it. But then also at the same time, bad things were going on in the world, and so there's the other meaning of dark skies. So then that was also part of it.
So you kind of it's something that's both beautiful, but also, and some of your work, it almost looks haunting in a way. It's sort of the theme I'm getting out of it. It's sort of a weird thing where it's both beautiful and awe-inspiring, but also a little bit unsettling, I guess. Is that what you're
doing? Well, that's the thing that always like affects me. It's like, you know, if you just have a painting of a pretty cat, or, you know, like a nice, then it's beautiful. But it's beautiful. It's beautiful in relationship to itself. But when there's something, the aim for me is when there's, with that haunting feeling you're talking about, there's an old-timey word for it called sublime, right? And it's when what you're looking for gives you that kind of chill of like, oh yeah, and then we die, you know? And now we, would you like a shot of tequila?
Drink to that.
When you think about sublime in your work, in your photography, is that there?
Yeah, I mean, the shots that I, of my own work that I enjoy the most are the ones that are sort of surreal and very real. It's not necessarily, like, my subjects aren't threatening, right? They're not anything that you should logically be afraid of, but they're still startling and unsettling sometimes to see a galaxy millions of light years away and that is interacting and merging with another one. It's this grand cosmic scene that isn't really affecting you in any way, shape, or form, but it's, to me, it's still a little bit...
Well, it is.
I mean, it's affecting you emotionally, right?
But it also actually sort of is affecting you because you're here.
True.
Right? Yeah. And one little, like, flick of its tail could wipe out you and...
Yeah, if I were close enough. Yeah, I mean, it is... It's beautiful, but also in a way, it is just a bit strange to think about and where we are in the universe. But also, you know, like sprites, these are some of my favorite things to photograph, and especially this time of year when we have the
lightning.
There are these strange electrical discharges from lightning that occur well above thunderstorms. They're about... The bottoms are about 20 miles up, and the tops are roughly 60 miles up. So the whole thing's maybe 30 miles across or more. And they're vibrant red. So there's...
Wait, okay, I haven't seen these.
Well, I'll have to show you a picture, I guess.
I look at thunderstorms all the time, and I have never seen...
They're discovered in 1989. Here are some from the other night. Just so you understand what I'm talking about, and we can put this on the screen too. For example, here is from the visitor center at the observatory.
What? That was there?
Yeah, and you can see the red form above it.
I've never seen that.
They're very brief. They last milliseconds.
So how do you know when to look for them?
You don't. Yeah, just get lucky. So, I mean, you aim above severe thunderstorms. You know, I work out how far away the storm is, and thus where their altitude should be, and then I just
watch
them.
This is an awesome photo.
Thank you. I like them because they are so surreal.
And what are they?
They're called sprites, and they happen when there is an exceptionally powerful lightning strike, and there is an electric charge on the edge of space. And the massive lightning strike, as it goes from the cloud to the ground, suddenly changes the electric field of the whole cloud, and then charge comes from basically the edge of space down to the atmosphere, and it fluoresces the nitrogen and makes it glow red.
And that's what makes it red?
Yeah, it's nitrogen.
Holy shit. It's just that some patterns, like there's a Malevich painting, it's a rectangle with another rectangle, like sort of a little square more like a square off to the side of it. So it's as simple as geometry can get, but one thing's tilted like this, and you just look at this and you get this feeling of the instability. Like if you saw a giant rock that was up on its end, and then how chipped could the rock be before, when you looked at the rock, it gave you this feeling of like danger.
Yeah.
Right?
The potential is there.
Yeah, so it's a geometric thing, and it changes. You know, like, I'm always the first person that notices if a ladder is not stable. And it might have to do with, because I'm spend time like thinking of geometric things, or maybe because one year I had a job as a house painter and I was the one that had to do the third story window, and I was painting the attic window, and it was like I was up on this really tall three stories on an aluminum ladder, and we were on a hill and it was near the ocean, so the aluminum ladder was already going like this. So I'm up there on this, like, and I was the one, because I'm a good painter, so I could cut in the little lines and not have to. So I'm up there like this and the shutters, and all of a sudden I'm face to face with this bat, because I'd moved the shutters. Like, and so it was everything I could do to not step back off the ladder and away from the bat. So it might be that.
and even the Earth, you know, we feel a gravitational influence from the Sun and the Moon and Jupiter, and to a lesser extent the other planets, that influences our motion and where we are in space. And yeah, the positions of the planets in the solar system aren't accidental. They didn't necessarily form where they are now, but they settled naturally into where they are because of the influence of the other planets and the Sun.
And the spaces between the galaxies, are they governed by the same kind of rules?
It's a little different, but I mean, yeah, there are vast periods of nothing where essentially there are orbits which are unstable, we would say. Like for example, the Milky Way, our galaxy, has a couple of smaller dwarf galaxies in orbit around it.
Really?
Yeah, they're smaller. You can see them with the naked eye if you're in Australia. They're called the Large and Small Magellanic Clouds, and they're only visible in the southern.
Say that again, Magellanic?
Magellanic, like the Strait of Magellan.
Oh!
So they're very far south in the sky, so you can't see them from here in Texas. But they're two smaller galaxies which are in orbit around the Milky Way. And there likely were other galaxies, smaller galaxies, that have long since merged and become part of the larger Milky Way. But basically there are spaces where, you know, things, if something were to exist, it would just become part of a larger whole, or couldn't remain there very long. There's basically kind of regions in space around a galaxy that are stable in their orbits.
Is our galaxy orbiting around anyone else?
We are being drawn towards our nearest large neighbor, the Andromeda Galaxy. It's about 2.5 million light years away right now, but in about 4.5 or 5 billion years, the two of us will merge together and form one great big galaxy. So when we'll get too close, we'll become unstable and we'll merge together. So it'll be an exciting time to look at the sky in about 5 billion years. it'll be like a double Milky Way for a little while. But by that time, also the sun will be
dying. It'll be a double Milky Way, so it'll look like two disks. Okay, so you got two disks, one big disk and one little disk.
So you would see the other galaxy Andromeda get bigger and bigger as a big fuzzy part in the sky. And so eventually it's just enormous. And then when the two actually combine, there'll be a burst of new star formation.
Will they come in like sideways or like that way?
So here's the Milky Way in the sky, right?
Okay.
Andromeda at the moment, from your perspective, it's like here.
But is it like
bigger
this?
And bigger. It's slightly crooked.
It's another big disk.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is us little disc, and this is Andromeda big disc.
A little bit, yeah.
And it's sort of like that at a right angle?
Yeah, it's slightly tilted, but yeah. And then it will start to sort of deform and get all smushed together in a few billion years as the two actually tidally disrupt each other and their gravity tears each other.
Did you say tidally?
Yeah, like tides. Tides.
Oh, okay. I was thinking tidy, like tidy up your room.
No, like tide as in like the moon. Kind of yeah. Yeah, so, yeah.
Say that tidally.
Tidally.
Interrupt each other.
Interact. Yeah, the tidal interactions or disruptions will smear apart our shapes, and it will be an incredible sky for a little while, but the sun will also be in the middle of dying at that time, so we'll have bigger things to worry about in 5 billion years. But
I like all those words together. You know, it really sounds like, I like the pictures and the words that makes.
Yeah, it's pretty to think about, yeah.
Yeah.
I'll have to make a time machine, freeze myself or something, come back in 5 billion years.
But first you need a point of view.
Yeah.
Right? You need a place to stand and watch it.
That's
on,
true.
Which is perspective.
Exactly.
Okay, that's one of my favorite things is to stand in the, if I stand in my front yard, I can see just the top of one mountain in Mexico. And I go, I can see Mexico from here.
Exactly.
And when I stand on the back porch at night, like, so I go out, and there's the Milky Way, like, big as can be, and I look at it, and I go, here I am, and I can see, I'm looking across the sideways part of the disk of my galaxy, and it's like, you are here, and there's 250 billion...
Roughly. We haven't counted it. The grad students are still working on that number.
Okay, more or less, 250 billion more or less stars in the galaxy, and 250 or 300 billion more or less galaxies in the known universe. So standing here on my back porch looking at the Milky Way, that's what I can think of, and it gives me perspective. And it makes me know how, it's a reminder every night of how insignificant I am and how little it matters what I do. And for some reason that comforts me like crazy, and I can get up the next morning and work with, I don't know, free, with freedom.
Yeah.
With freedom.
It's,
yeah.
It is somewhat freeing to know that we are just a one tiny little speck in this grand universe above us and around us. I think it's freeing, and I'm glad you do too. And that's like I'm a photographer, and I came into photography from a perspective more of a just documenting what's out there in the universe, just trying to use photography to show what the eye can't see, but is nonetheless still very real out there in the universe. And I get that same sense of just feeling minuscule, but somehow free when I look up into the night sky and when I see these pictures off of telescopes and things. It's something that words can't really describe. You know, it's just an emotion that I hope everyone gets to experience. That just looking up and realizing where you are.
Yes. And the fact that. What is the percentage of people now that, you know, like...
About 80% of Americans, at least, live in an area with too much light pollution to see the Milky Way.
Okay, that's even more than I thought. That's...
Yeah. And so, entire generations are growing up. Kids are growing up not realizing that it's possible to see the Milky Way in some places. That used to be normal.
Right, and it's light pollution. It's like, and it's so simple to fix. All you do is put a shade on the light so it's pointing down instead of diffusing into the air. I mean, that really is not rocket science.
Nope.